Hello, everyone, and welcome to the 2015 Mayor's Awards and ADA Anniversary Celebration. Before we would begin, I'd like to say that we had a change in our interpreting services. Our interpreting services will be done by Deaf Communications Services. The Commission on Disability, and I also like to thank the Commission on Disability, those members of the Commission on Disability who have worked hard to plan and coordinate this event, and also those community members who took the time to submit nominations for this time-honored event. The purpose of the Mayor's Awards is to recognize those members of the community who have shown a commitment to the advancement and inclusion of people with disabilities in Fort Collins. We are here today not to be inspired, rather to exemplify and pursue the ideals of equal access and opportunity for every member of our community. As our city grows and continues to become more diverse, it's important to remember that disability is a unique perspective that enriches and the values of Fort Collins, the culture and values of Fort Collins. Many decisions will be made regarding the future of this great city, and people with disabilities also deserve a seat at that table. We need influential leaders, like those nominated today, who will continue to give unique perspectives, come up with new innovations, and bring to the forefront the concerns of people with disabilities to ensure that Fort Collins remains a choice city for everyone. Unfortunately, Mayor Troxel was unable to join us today because of a prior commitment, but he has prepared a videotape message for us in his absence, which we will present now.
Hi, I'm Mayor Wade Troxel, and I'm sorry I can't attend these awards, which celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act. The Mayor's Awards and Luncheon have been a Fort Collins tradition for more than 30 years. It recognizes individuals, businesses, and organizations who go above and beyond as advocates for those in our city who are challenged by disability. It allows the mayor a chance to say thank you to those who have touched the lives of others in our community. Today, we honor Foothills Gateway, ARC, CSU, and local and national employers like the Silver Grill and King Soopers, along with scores of individuals who give of themselves in numerous ways to create a more just and inclusive community. Again, please accept my sincere regrets and my hearty congratulations to those award winners. Thank you, and have a great luncheon.
Now it is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you someone who has worked as an advocate for people with disabilities in Northern Colorado for over 30 years. Please help me welcome our keynote speaker today, Nancy Jackson, the Executive Director of Disabled Resource Services.
I'm pleased to join you today for the Mayor's Awards event and to say a very happy 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act. Although the actual anniversary was July 26th, who says we can't celebrate this historic event all year long? I think it's a great idea. On July 26, 1990, President George H.W. Bush signed into law the Americans with Disabilities Act to ensure the civil rights for people with disabilities. This legislation established a clear national mandate for the elimination of discrimination against people with disabilities. The ADA and the ADA amendments of 2008 give protection to individuals with disabilities similar to those on the basis of race, color, sex, national origin, age, and religion. It assures equal access to businesses, employment, transportation, telecommunication, and government services. The ADA has expanded opportunities, reduced barriers, and changed perceptions for people with disabilities, and has given them full participation in community life. These are the words spoken by President Bush as he signed the ADA. And now I sign legislation which takes a sledgehammer to another wall, one which for too many generations separated Americans with disabilities from the freedom they could glimpse but could not grasp. Once again, we rejoice as the barriers fall, proclaiming together, we will not accept, we will not excuse, we will not tolerate discrimination in America. As Terry said, I'm Nancy Jackson, the Director of Disabled Resource Services, the Center for Independent Living here in Fort Collins, which covers Larimer and Jackson counties in its catchment area. And yes, I was working at my agency in 1990 when the ADA became law. In fact, I thought that perhaps the reason why I was selected to be the keynote speaker was because I'm so old and I was around way back then. Before the ADA came into law, it already had a huge impression on one of my board members, Shirley Reichenbaugh. So much so that she booked a flight to Washington, D.C. so she could witness the signing of the ADA. Back then, it wasn't easy for a person who used a wheelchair for their mobility to make a trip like that, to arrange travel, transportation, lodging, figuring out what restaurant to eat in that was accessible. But she was one of our own from our community that went to that historic event in that moment in time. Shirley sat in the first row, front and center, when the ADA was signed. She captured that historic moment with a photo and later presented me with a t-shirt commemorating it. And I'm not really a hoarder by nature, but I do have that t-shirt with me today. And I want to share it with you. It says, Independence Day number one. Well, folks, today is Independence Day number 9,206 for the largest minority group in the United States. Yeah, let's give us a hand. So let's talk a little bit about what it was like before the ADA. Before it became law, people using wheelchairs experienced buildings they couldn't get into because of stairs. That included post offices, businesses, government offices, movie theaters, and museums. The accessible buildings that did exist had poor signage and to their access ramps, and the restrooms didn't have stalls large enough for wheelchair access. Retail stores and shops had aisles that were cluttered with merchandise or they were too narrow. There weren't elevators to reach other floors in a building. Sidewalks had few, if any, curb cuts. So oftentimes you would see a person using a wheelchair traveling along the path of travel as other vehicles and putting themselves in danger. But it was the only accessible path of travel. People with vision loss didn't have braille or large print materials when they went to receive services from agencies, and also menus at restaurants didn't have braille or large print. There was a lack of signage identifying restrooms and offices in public buildings, and those using guide dogs, they were often excluded from restaurants and from grocery stores. People with hearing loss, they didn't have sign language interpreters at medical appointments, therapy sessions, during hospitalizations, at parent-teacher conferences, or school activities, unless they brought their own interpreter, which often was a family member, and sometimes their own child. We had created a nation that didn't include people with disabilities. They were shamefully excluded from participating in American society. I remember a neighbor of mine, her name was Peggy, and she wasn't allowed to go to high school. I told you I was old. Instead, she had a tutor that came to her home so that she could get an education. And I couldn't understand why she couldn't go to high school with the rest of us neighborhood kids. Well, that was a time when, I'm sorry to say, where we accepted exclusion, and that was wrong. A person by the name of Lex Fryden of Houston, Texas, was instrumental in developing the Americans with Disabilities Act. He's highly acclaimed and is acknowledged for his work in the disability field. In fact, he's received 2 presidential citations. During April and May of this year, Lex conducted a non-scientific survey to measure the ADA's impact among 725 disability community leaders and advocates who represent over 600 communities across the United States. 2/3 of them said that the ADA was the most significant social, cultural, and legislative influence on their lives in the past 25 years. That is amazing. Since 1990, much progress has been made in our community in the areas of accessibility and integration, employment of people with disabilities, affordable, accessible housing, playgrounds, transportation, and more recently, moving towards more accessible bus stops. With these achievements, decades of citizenship without equality has ended. Not only has our community become more inviting to all people, but there's more community engagement by people with disabilities, and as a result, they're more visible in daily life in our community, as they should be. But there's still more to do. The survey results showed employment, achieving economic independence, and removing disincentives to getting jobs ranked as the highest in what remains to be accomplished with the ADA. Eliminating the fear of benefit loss among prospective workers with disabilities while enabling them to raise their standard of living and paying taxes will close the gap that exists between unemployment among the general public and people with disabilities. Studies show that at least 50% of working age adults with disabilities seeking employment cannot find work. Like employment, respondents also indicated that access to health care and accessible housing are other areas the ADA can have an impact. It's a proven fact that community-based health care is significantly lower in cost than hospital emergency rooms for routine treatment. Durable medical equipment must become affordable if individuals with disabilities are to function as independently as possible. Due to current Medicare and Medicaid guidelines and private insurance restrictions, assistive devices and equipment often are not covered for people who need them. In addition, lengthy delays associated with extended approval processes can result in added medical complications for people with disabilities. In Fort Collins, there are similar areas of improvement, particularly concerning affordable housing, employment, and transportation. So let's look to the future. The future holds promise for continued progress and improvement. Our community has come a long ways over the years. Let's not remain idle, though, while there's more work to be done. In our community, we have the wonderful Fort Collins Commission on Disability to serve as a compass to ensure the ADA as the Bill of Rights for people with disabilities fulfills equal opportunity, non-discrimination, and inclusion. There are also agencies working in partnership to ensure a better future for people with disabilities, including the Arc of Larimer County, Foothills Gateway, the National MS Society, the Center for Community Partnerships, the Division of Vocational Rehabilitation, the Office of Resources for Disabled Students, and my own agency, Disabled Resource Services. The full promise of the ADA will only be reached if we remain committed to continuing our efforts, not just as organizations, but each of us as individuals. Because the ADA is compared to the Civil Rights Act of 1964, I'd like to close with the words of John Kerry, spoken at the funeral of Rosa Parks. Now, how many of you know Rosa Parks? Okay, how many think you know the story about Rosa Parks? Okay, well, bear with me, because I thought I knew the story about Rosa Parks, and I found out that I really didn't. So let me tell you what I thought I knew, and then I'll tell you what I found out, and then I'll close. So what I thought was that Rosa Parks sat down in the white section of a segregated bus because she was tired and her feet hurt because she worked at a retail store. Well, that's not exactly true. So what I learned was that back in Montgomery, Alabama, the segregated bus had a moving line. And originally it started where 50% of the bus was for the whites and the other 50% was for people who were at that time called colored. Well, people that got on the bus who were black, they had to go up the front entrance into the bus, pay their fare, get off the bus, walk down to the back of the bus, get on the colored entrance, or get into the back of the bus through the colored entrance and sit down. Now, if there were more white people that got on the bus than what the capacity was for that 50% of the white section of the bus, they started moving the line back so that it encroached on the black section, and then black people were expected to stand up and give their seats to white people. How many people knew that? Smart people out here in the audience. Well, I didn't know that. And that is the story about Rosa Parks. The line got moved so that it included her section where she was sitting, and there were four seats there. Three of the people got up to give their seats to white people, and Rosa didn't. But do you know why she didn't? It wasn't because her feet hurt, but it was because she was tired. She was tired of giving up and giving in. And for that act of civil disobedience, she was arrested and fined. Now, Rosa Parks was the forerunner of desegregation, and it was the platform on which Martin Luther King Jr. made a very successful civil rights movement for the freedom of black people and equal opportunity and access for them. So, with John Kerry's closing remarks, he said, "Rosa Parks sat down so we could stand up, but not stand still. So I ask each of you to join me in never standing still for the equal rights, the removal of discrimination, for the full embracement of all people with disabilities in our Choice community today and in the future. Thank you.
I'm now going to introduce Hetty Huber, who will be presenting an award to our former city liaison, Roseanne.
Welcome, everybody. I'm so glad to see so many faces, so many new folks, so many people that are so familiar to me. Today, I'd like to take just a few minutes to recognize Roseanne McDonald. You know, we give out like a limited number of awards, and I wish that we could have like awards for all different sorts of people who do all sorts of different things. But the city doesn't let us do that. But nevertheless, from 2009 until earlier this year, the city provided us with this really wonderful support system. And she's moved on to a new position, and we have a really great new person, Don Nelson, who we're excited about. But we wanted to let everybody know just how important Roseanne has been to our commission, to this event, to ourselves. And I especially would like to say thank you, because she's just always been so encouraging and so really wonderful. Let me grab her. I got my cart before my horse. Roseanne, come on up here. Every year at Mayor's Awards time, she takes about 6 phone calls a day from me for like the 3 weeks prior to the event, because nothing ever seems to be quite as smooth as I would like it in my world. She is a person who, you know, sometimes you meet somebody who you just think, gosh, really likes her job. Like, she just really likes what she does. And Roseanne is that kind of person. Every time we've ever stopped at her office, she's had candy for my girls, which is a plus and a minus all at the same time. She's just really a wonderful, wonderful person. And we appreciate so much everything you've done for the commission. And so here's your own Mayor's Awards to hang on your wall in a little card. Thanks so much. We really appreciate you. All right. Thanks so much, everybody.
I would also like to echo those sentiments as well. Thank you, Roseanne, for everything you've done. And thank you, Hetty, for such a longstanding record of hard work setting up these events and all the things behind the scene that you've done for the commission. It's truly appreciated. At this time, we would like to present a special partnership award to Emma Belmont, Transit Coordinator for Transport. Unfortunately, Emma could not be here today because she is busy getting ready to welcome a new baby into the world. She has worked diligently to address public transportation issues affecting people with disabilities. Emma attends the Commission's monthly meetings and is always willing to listen to concerns of the community. Her ability to find answers and suggest ways to affect change, along with her commitment, demonstrates that she is truly a partner with community members in advocating for equal access. On behalf of the Fort Collins Commission on Disabilities, thank you, Emma, for your dedication. At this time, the Commission on Disability would now like to recognize the many well-deserved nominees for today's awards and present them with certificates of recognition. Well, one person nominated today could not be here because he's no longer with us, but he was a valued member of our community, Barney Akabadaka. And then we have Chrissy Crum. Thank you, Chrissy. Columbine Health Systems. S- Sue Carroll. Joanne Vandewall. The City of Fort Collins Recreation Department. Charlene Reed. Marimont Fitness. COD member Rose Luna. Aaron Evan Sioski. Matt Cloven. Kanae Job. COD member Marilee Boyland. Brenda Pasher Carroll. Judy Detmer Johnson. Elder House and Mindset. Jan Larson. Julie Wolf. Dennis Vanderheim. Mary Seaman. Ayushi Kaul. Pooter High School. Kate Kazakowski. And Dr. William Trethwartha. How about a round of applause for all our nominees today? Now I'd like to introduce to you the presenter of the 2015 Mayor's Awards, Councilmember Bob Overbeck. He has served as our liaison to City Council and has been an ally to our cause for many years. Thank you, Bob, and welcome to our Mayor's Awards.
Thank you, Terry. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. And I again want to acknowledge Roseanne McDonald for her great work for this community, and also want to thank the mayor for allowing me the privilege to speak with you and present today. This year is an important milestone for equality and inclusion and for citizens with disabilities. Let's talk today about change. Let's talk about revolution. Let's talk about the history and the progression of a movement that has changed the life of Americans, America's largest minority, people living with disabilities. Today we celebrate the 25th anniversary of the American Disabilities Act, a landmark piece of legislation that offered the promise that all people with disabilities be fully equal, fully productive, fully prosperous, fully welcome participants in the mainstream. Those are the words of Justin Dart, polio survivor, human rights activist, Presidential Medal of Freedom recipient, and the acknowledged father of the ADA. And I didn't know that until today. Mr. Dart recognized that the struggle to gain full inclusion for people with disabilities started before him and would continue after he was gone. Indeed, we gather here today. We can look back to 1945, when the nation determined to employ the physically handicapped every October. We can think of the passage of the Education for All Handicapped Children Act of 1975 and its successor, the Individuals with Disability Act of 2004, Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, the Air Carrier Access Act, the Civil Rights for Institutionalized Person Act, the Voting Accessibility for Elderly and Handicapped Act, All these offer a promise, just as the ADA does. But there is one thing we can guarantee. It is that we keep those promises, and it isn't easy. It isn't easy, and it takes more than government. It takes more than observances and guidelines and laws. It takes leadership and vision and the will of the people. People like you. Our awards cover a broad range of disability advocacy. You might have a disability and devote your time to helping others with disabilities. You might have a disability, and perhaps you bring people with disabilities on board at your workplace, or show yourself to be an exemplary employee and a champion for disability rights. Maybe you are an advocate, a voice. Whatever your role, you are a patriot in this revolution. And today, you've been invited here because in one way or another, you are keeping the promise here in Fort Collins. Let's meet our award recipients. October is National Disability Employment Awareness Month, with aims to celebrate and recognize the accomplishments in the workplace of men and women with disabilities and reaffirm the commitment to ensuring equal employment opportunities for all citizens. The observance can be traced back to 1945, and while much has been accomplished over the past 70 years, the fact remains that only 21.5% of Americans living with disabilities are employed full-time. That's what makes our first award recipient so vital. This year, we are pleased to award Jeff Sutton with the 2015 Employer of the Year Award. Accepting this award for Jeff today is Janet Vigil and Thorben Sellers. Will you please join me? Here, please step in front of the mic and share with us.
Jefferson's his apologies, and we're really honored to receive this. The other part is we're really glad that Dylan kept us and is still working for us. Thank you.
So just to acknowledge again, the Employer of the Year Award recognizes the employer who provides the authentic work opportunities for people with disabilities and who creates a positive, supportive, and workplace for others who work with those with disabilities. And as a member of the CSU maintenance team, I think I might have jumped here a little bit. Nope, Jeff is doing that. He has taken the lead, both in terms of bringing on staff members who have disabilities and encouraging other departments to consider hiring individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities. He is also partnering with our local school district and their vocational transition programs to create opportunities for success for students. So again, thank you very much for accepting the award on behalf of Jeff. Ladies and gentlemen, our 2015 Employer of the Year, Jeff Sutton. Our next award, the Employee of the Year, honors an individual who embraces his or her daily call to do the impactful, life-changing work for and with people with disabilities. And we are pleased to recognize an educator this year. The vision to provide a free and appropriate public education to every American child is now 40 years old. And that as a nation, we are still grappling how to meet the demands of this civil right. Having educators like Lisa Hernandez is a distinct advantage. Lisa, would you please join me? Lisa is a board-certified behavior analyst in the Poudre School District, a speech-language pathologist, and the district lead autism coach. Every day she collaborates with parents and with her colleagues to ensure the best outcome for kids. She is described as dedicated, a natural leader, trustworthy, the glue that holds autism department together, and a replaceable asset. One grateful mom says, her creativity, her expertise, and her caring heart, Lisa stands out to me. She says, because she's consistently gleeful about my children's progress. Lisa, for pushing students to achieve their best, for your compassion, your big heart, and your determination to keep the promise, I'm pleased to present to you the 2015 Employer of the Year Award. So please give Lisa a hand again. The Slice Adaptive Swim, formerly called the Special Needs Swim, has been keeping the promise in Fort Collins community for 40 years. And we are proud to present with our Service Provider of the Award year, and I'd like to invite the Slice attendees to come forward. As they come up here, this award recognizes a business or organization that provides exemplary and life-enriching service to the people with disabilities. And while we could say many things about the program, how it impacts volunteers and participants, let's take a look at the short clip instead.
We are at the Epic Center in Fort Collins at the community swimming pool getting ready for Special Needs Swim.
Special Needs Swim is a program where CSU students are partnered with youth in the Fort Collins community with physical, mental, or developmental disabilities.
Special Needs Swim has been a program for over 30 years. Special Needs Swim is run out of the Slice office. They help to fund and promote programs that work with people with disabilities, and they help student coordinators like myself with all the necessary means to get the program up and running and to really make sure that it's thriving and that we can do as much as we can for the population we work with.
One of the best parts of my week is when Russell and I first get to meet before we get to go in the pool, and we're both so excited to get in the pool and just have a great time.
It's definitely not about swimming lessons. We're here basically just to have a good time.
Lives are changed through the connections that CSU students make with the people that we work with. So we're very meticulous about who we match and how we match them, and making sure that things people have in common are matched together, or the skills that they want are matched, and personalities, they start to really care about one another.
Although most of the participants in Special Needs Swim do have some sort of disability, it's been great for me to realize that despite those disabilities, we all have something in common.
Caring about other people has, I think, helped a lot of the volunteers figure out what they wanted to do in life and maybe focus a lot of their goals on more people-oriented skills. And they know their ability to brighten someone's day and know what it's like to have somebody really touch their lives. And so taking that into the future and how they interact with others.
Not only are we engaging in the community and participating in volunteerism, but we are also engaged with a population within our community that is very often overlooked, forgotten about, and misunderstood. So the journey of changing the world that we all want has to start within yourself. So you change yourself and you can lead by example within that. And I think that the organizations supported by the Slice office and engagement on campus start these conversations. Community engagement is so important within your college experience because it allows you to shape your character and be changed by the people that you live with.
Thank you for that video. As they say, a picture's worth a thousand words, and you can see why it's significant and important, the work that they do. I want to say additionally, it's easy to see why Slice Adaptive Swim has endured. It embraces the spirit and promise of the ADA before the ADA was a reality, and you can't stop that sort of passion. The program is life-enriching and life-changing for everyone who takes part in it. It makes a place for friendships to grow, shapes the character of tomorrow's decision makers, exhibits respect for all people in their diversity, and teaches the principles that keeping promises is necessary, rewarding, and even fun. For all they've done for the last 40 years to bring joy to our community, Slice Adaptive Swim is awarded the 2015 Service Provider of the Year Award. Again, congratulations. Thank you. Every year the Commission faces at least one tough call, and this year, Volunteer of the Year field has been especially rich. If it were possible, we bring all six nominees up here and just stand back and say, wow. The award is meant to honor an individual who contributes his or her time, effort, heart to making our community a more compassionate, more just home for people with disabilities, and every single nominee truly embodies that idea. Nevertheless, the commission had to come and make a decision. And they feel rather proud that they were able to whittle it down to just two. Our first Volunteer of the Year Award recipient is Linda Miller, who, in addition to being a busy mom, is also a community leader, event planner, newsletter editor, sibling support, group founder, fundraiser. You get the idea. Linda, thank you very much. Linda received three nominations, and not one ran out of good things to say about her commitment and passion to Fort Collins community and to improving the lives for people with disabilities. Her oldest son was diagnosed with autism, and she has truly dedicated herself to reaching out, creating change, and keeping the promises. She has worked to bring Carolyn's Carts, which combines the utility of a shopping cart with the necessity of a wheelchair, to Fort Collins, increasing the ability of caregivers and their love to participate in the very simple task, shopping for groceries. Fostering that sort of everyday inclusion keeps the promise. So again, thank you very much, Linda. Thank you. Next up is Brad Nelson, who was unable to join us today, and he's also known by Coach to a whole generation of kids with special needs. Not only does Brad work as an adaptive PE teacher for the Thompson School District, but he also devotes his countless hours of his spare time as a volunteer in our adaptive recreation program. For the past decade, he has served as a referee, assisted at the ARO Water Sports Day at Horsetooth Reservoir, been a workout partner for Drop in Fitness, chaperone dinners, help with adaptive cycling programs. He has worked to raise the funding needs to give children with disabilities a chance to participate in adaptive ski trips. In doing this, he has secured the promise of equal access, impacting the lives of so many kids, teens, adults with disabilities here in Fort Collins. More than that, he has made building relationships with these folks his life work. We thank Brad for answering the call, and we are pleased to name him our Volunteer 2015 Award recipient. Please give Brad a hand. Thank you. The ADA, the IDEA, and the other significant pieces of disability rights legislation have this commonality. Somewhere along the line, a pioneer or patriot, just one really passionate mom has said, nope, that's not going to happen on my watch. And that's where Carrie Brown comes in. Carrie, would you please come up here? The Spirit of Fort Collins Award recognizes an individual, business, or organization that exemplifies the spirit of Fort Collins, not only in their acts of kindness, but also in their passion for creating change in respect for people with disabilities. Carrie Brown and her passion for justice have been a catalyst for change, not here in Fort Collins, but in the state of Colorado. And today we honor her. Carrie and her family moved to Fort Collins in 2013, in part to access important services for her son, who has autism. Quickly, she realized that benefits of the ABA therapies were unfairly restricted. Her efforts to improve the life of her own family became a mission. Beginning in October 2013, Carrie spearheaded efforts to update Colorado law to remove applied behavior analysis treatment caps. This process was critical so children with autism could have access to medically necessary levels of therapy through private commercial insurance. Her determination and passion has paid off with the passage of Senate Bill 15-105 for challenging the status quo. Taking on the system and keeping the promise, the City of Fort Collins is proud to present to you with the 2015 Spirit of Fort Collins Award. Thank you. The Dorothy Lastly Memorial Award is given every year to a person with a disability who is an active voice in the community, championing for the rights of people with disabilities. Consideration is given to the nominee's contribution to the community through volunteering, organizational membership, and community leadership. It is named for the Dorothy Lassley, who was diagnosed with the rheumatoid arthritis at the age of 2. This necessitated the use of a wheelchair for mobility and later caused the loss of Dorothy's eyesight. Ms. Lassley worked tirelessly through her lifetime towards removing both architectural and attunial barriers for citizens with disabilities. She's an advocate for people with disabilities, donating countless volunteer hours until her death in 1983. She worked for equal opportunities in employment, transportation, housing, and education, and independent living during a time when society was just beginning to recognize the value of including all citizens in daily life. A member of the very first Commission on Disability, in many ways, Dorothy was a pioneer. Certainly, she was a passionate keeper of the promise. As is our next recipient, John Morris. John, please join me at the podium. John is the CEO and founder of Quad Shocks, a brand new enterprise that creates technology to retrofit manual wheelchairs with a suspension system. Think of driving a car with no shocks and then transfer that to the context of using a wheelchair. What if every bump, every dip in the road, every slight imperfection in the surface you traveled was conducted directly to your body? The lack of suspension systems in manual wheelchairs results in needless pain. John saw that through his experience and then determined to do something about it. As CEO of Quad Shock, he has worked tirelessly to bring this important life-enriching technology to the market. A hope that is soon to be realized. He has attended symposiums, spoken on radio and television, been a presenter at the Rotary Club, and other organizations. He has visited with the Commission on Disabilities to share his mission, his dauntless advocacy, passion for his vision, and prepared to build on the promise of a greater access and greater inclusion for people with disabilities. Please join me in honoring our 2015 Dorothy Lassley Memorial Award, John Morris. John.
Hi, John.
I just want to say...
Yeah, let me hand you the mic over here, John.
We got a mic.
You got one?
Thank you so much. I'm so honored and humbled to accept this award and be standing in front of you today. Standing, that's a wheelchair joke for anybody. But none of this is possible without the support of my company, Terry, Mike. You guys literally have paved the way. Mike, you know this. You made my quality of life that much better for making access to the disability downtown area. That much better, man. I really appreciate it and what you've done. And you're just another factor in my life of why I want to succeed and do more for people with disabilities. Terry, you're one of the biggest parts and a big foundation of my success, man. Without you and your help at Colorado State, I would not be where I am today. And I truly thank you for all your support, your helping, and you've just inspired me to do more, man. And without my company, Ariana, Will, thank you so much. It's not over. We're going to keep going at this and show other people that anything is possible with disabilities. We may have mobility challenges, but we do not have ability challenges. Thank you.
Thank you. Again, thanks again to John Morris, an innovator here in Fort Collins. Ladies and gentlemen, these are award recipients. They are visionaries and everyday people, patriots and keeper of the promise. They are our call to action, and they motivate us to do more and to be better. They inspire but not just because they work alongside with people with disabilities or teach kids with disabilities, not because they love and care for someone with a disability, and not because they live with a disability. All of that is just life. They inspire because they know that keeping the promise of the ADA, the IDEA, and a myriad of other vital pieces of legislation that ensure the civil rights of people with disabilities is hard work, but they do it anyways. These honorees are not content to say, look at far we've come. Instead, they say, let's finish the job. Let's keep the promise. Each of them know that a disability can take many forms, some visible, some invisible. And that because they are all touched by a disability and because they are all connected, and more just, inclusive and community will benefit us all. Fort Collins is fortunate to have these people and businesses and organizations in our midst because they sharpen and strengthen us. One last thing. Here in Fort Collins, we like to say a world-class city. Each of you here today, award recipients, nominees, nominators, honored guests, understand that for that to be true, we must do better. You understand to be truly world-class, we have to have a world-class special education program. We have to have a world-class accessibility to recreation, city services, transportation, and community events. We have to have world-class opportunities for employment for every citizen who wants to work. We have to embrace the implementation with the Americans with Disabilities Act in a world-class way. Maybe what you understand, what you envision, and what you're willing to work towards is that world-class just isn't good enough for Fort Collins. When it comes to creating a place where everyone can learn and work and play and feel like a valued part of this community, when it comes to keeping the promises, Fort Collins should be a leader, the innovator, the trailblazer. Fort Collins should be striving to be a world, should be striving to be a world-class community all its own. And so I want to thank everybody for coming here and recognizing our recipients for the awards and just taking a moment and also thinking about the good work that's being done on behalf of citizens with disabilities and making a good community. And I just want to leave you with one final word here. It's always important that you reach out to City Council, to your Commission on Disabilities, if you think that we can improve lives for you in any way of all abilities. So we need your feedback to keep moving the ball forward. And we value your feedback always. So thank you again. And I turn it back over to Terry.
I am truly humbled and honored to be in the presence of so many wonderful people here today. Thanks everyone for coming. And thank you especially to all those who have done so many great things to make this a wonderful city to live in. This will conclude our ceremony.